Familiar faces and a few new ones too. So welcome to Chestnut Hill College, to our Sugarloaf campus, and to the Institute for Religion and Science at Chestnut Hill College, a regional center for exploring science and spirituality. So as many of you know, the Institute aims to promote the constructive engagement of religion and spirituality with science and technology. And to encourage dialogue in these areas, that's interfaith, multi-science, and civil, we sponsor lectures, a reading circle, and a variety of other events. So do check our website for a growing number of videos of past lectures, for a list of relevant books that are housed in our library, and for our blog. Also be sure to sign in at the desk if you're not already on our mailing list so that you can be aware of the programs that we're going to present. So we're just in the midst of planning for next year. It's very exciting. And so I encourage you to stay in touch and then to come and hear what we're doing. It's a pleasure for me tonight to introduce our speaker, Dr. Philip Clayton. Phil is presently the Ingaham Professor at Claremont School of Theology, as well as Joint Professor in the Department of Religion at Claremont University in Claremont, California. His areas of specialization are many: comparative theologies, constructive Christian theology, the future of faith, science and ethics, and technology, and for us, what's most exciting is science and religion. He's held teaching and administrative positions at Claremont Lincoln University, California State University, Williams College, and visiting positions at the University of Cambridge, Ludwig Maximilians University, and University of Munich in Munich, Germany, Harvard Divinity School, Williams College, and Haverford College. Phil is a prolific researcher, writer, and lecturer, the recipient of many fellowships and awards, especially in the area of science and religion. As an international lecturer, he's the author and editor of at least 23 books and numerous scholarly publications. Over the last 25 years, Phil has been involved in many projects with the John Templeton Foundation as consultant and principal investigator. I would love to be able to share some of the details, but if I did, I think I would take up all the time and poor Phil would be left with no time to say what he needs to say. So I'll stop here except to say that we are so fortunate to be able to spend the next hour and a half with a person of deep faith, a person who loves life, and a truly integrated scholar. So please join me in welcoming Phil Clayton.
Thanks and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Sister Kathleen, for that generous, typically generous introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate the work of our host, the Institute for Religion and Science. Of all the issues that they cover, and of any issue at that intersection that you may have confronted, probably none is more intimate to us than the question of brain and consciousness. Probably no question more profoundly influences our understanding of ourselves than that one. And I admit, as somebody who sort of talks about these questions for a living, that on many of the topics, I'm inclined to wax poetic, as I did yesterday at Villanova, and to explore the sort of broader reaches in a looser and more exploratory way. But ladies and gentlemen, this one is so serious, and the evidence for the other side, if I may, is so strong that this one takes our closest attention. So I'm asking actually of you a little bit more as an audience, just as I'll ask more of myself as a speaker. I really want to sit with the science tonight. I want to go slowly. I want to look at what we actually know, not the myths, not the overstatements, though I'll mention two of them at the beginning, just as a sounding board, right, as an other. But I just really want to look at the charge against those of us who believe that religion and spirituality are meaningful, that life is meaningful, that we are persons who live in value-based relationships with other persons around us. And those are no longer obvious in light of today's neuroscience. So are you ready? You know, take off your shoes, roll up your sleeves, and at the end, we'll struggle together as we move into the discussion time about some of these areas. I'd like to end with a voice of faith. I am a person for whom religious faith is really important, but I feel, to use the Hebrew scripture, that we need to first walk through the valley of the shadow of death and to understand this challenge before we can talk about coming out the other side, right? Ladies and gentlemen, there is every reason to view human consciousness as the product of neurons and neural connections. There's every reason to doubt whether our common sense of ourselves, is accurate. As we look at the human brain, we recognize the most amazing part of what we have evolved to be. What you're looking at now is a simulation of the most complex interconnected system that we have yet discovered in the entire universe, residing within your own head. Watch for a moment as we take here, thanks to Shutterstock, an imaginary journey through the brain. Without this organ, without these neural connections, you would not be focusing on this talk, listening to my words, understanding, forming responses within yourself to what I say, worrying about the shopping list and whether you turn the burner off, right, or the car lights on the car. This is perhaps the most wondrous thing about us. This is the organ that makes us aware of our most intimate experiences, our feelings, our introspection, our experiences of sexual pleasure, of human companionship, of beauty, and of spiritual encounter. And yet, as the knowledge of this organ, the brain, grows, the challenge to our common sense understanding of ourselves and to many of our philosophical and theological traditions grows as well. Francis Crick says, "You are nothing but a pack of neurons," punning on Alice in Wonderland, right? You're nothing but a pack of cards. Mm-hmm. And in this book, The Amazing Hypothesis, he raises that challenge. Recently, I was at a seminar on brain and consciousness, and a neuroscientist from University of California, San Francisco said, "Wires and chemicals, that's all we are, wires and chemicals." Could it be in the end that the chemists among you, there are several here, professional chemists, and the electrical engineers are the ones best suited to understand what the human person really is? Not the philosophers, not the theologians among us, not the religious practitioners. That, ladies and gentlemen, is the charge that we face. Let me show you just one piece of the data so that you have some sense. This comes from the Libet experiments, first done in 1948. This raises the question of human freedom. Are we really free? So here you have the attempt by neuroscientists to predict a decision from certain micro patterns of brain activity before the person has acted, and indeed before the person is even aware what his or her decision is going to be. And they do it by studying readiness potentials these are milliseconds, right? And here they find, at this point, is an onset of predictive information, these firings in the brain that they can recognize. And then here at the red line is the point where the person feels that she made the decision to push either the left or the right button. And then the button press comes later, all right? It looks like one of two things is true. Either our brain sets in motion the decision, let's say to push the left button, and then we have here, this is what Libet first said, a chance to veto a motion that our brain's already set in motion, a plan, and then before we actually press the button. So the consciousness is a possibility of saying no, but not the initiation of the action. That's what the data by Benjamin Libet suggested. That's the optimistic interpretation. Many today have a far more pessimistic interpretation. We simply aren't free. The brain is doing these things based on electrochemical processes. The brain makes a decision that we're not aware of. Some, I think it's about 200 milliseconds later, the consciousness becomes aware of what we're about to do, and then we do it. And because we're aware of what we're about to do before we do it, we make the mistake of thinking that our awareness caused the action. That's what the critics say. This debate first opened, it was during open brain surgeries in 1948 in San Francisco, surgeries that are now outlawed, that he had access to these brains and did this other research while the brains were open, something that nowadays would be completely unethical in any hospital, just in case you're worried that somebody might be doing this kind of experiment when your brain, you know, is exposed to the world. And it is hotly debated in these years continuously with our new ability to gain information. Do you guys get it?
Yeah.
How this question about the brain raises very uncomfortable questions. That's why I want you to hold on to your seat and really walk with me through a presentation of their argument and then why I think they're wrong. And that's our goal together by the time that I stop speaking, no later than 8 o'clock. All right, so let's do it in a few parts. The first part is genes, neural Darwinism, and brain plasticity. It turns out that answering this charge, you're not free, you're not persons, value does not exist, and you cannot know God. Are we clear on what their charges are here? Right. The way to answer that is to stop thinking about the brain by itself, as a given, as a sort of deterministic system, and to think completely differently about what this thing is. Now, I don't mean completely differently in that you all become Cartesians, and you say, oh, well, that's just res extensa, extended stuff. It doesn't really do anything. It's just a machine with gears inside. And what really matters is res cogitans, thinking stuff, the soul. And that's going to do all the work, and it's going to just tell the mere machine of the body what to do. And it's going to use the pineal gland, this little gland that Descartes didn't know what it did. So he said, oh, well, that's where the soul talks to the body, right? So the answer is not that way. We actually do have to walk a little bit further into the science, lest we negate it altogether. We need to get to the level of the story of life itself, how organisms are formed, how they evolved, and how they adapt. And if you can understand that, the core story of biology, then I think we'll find our way through the valley of the shadow of death. Ladies and gentlemen, between the 1930s and roughly the year 2000, evolutionary theorists focused on genes, the chemical structures that transmit the blueprint for building a new organism from the parents. And the quest was at first to identify the structure. As you know, we succeeded in identifying the structure. It was 1953 when Crick and Watson went running out of their lab and down to the pub in Cambridge where all the other biologists hung out, blasted through the door. I've been there. It's almost like there's a plaque on the door still, right? Knocked over everybody's pint of, what would it have been, right? of bitter or ale or whatever it was, Guinness, and said, what? Stout, there we go. I've knocked over your stout, I'm so sorry, but we've just discovered the secret of life. And people said, what? What have you been drinking? And in a sense, it was true. When they discovered this molecule, the deoxyribonucleic acid or DNA molecule, they had found the secret of how organisms make copies of themselves. We could talk for an hour about this amazing molecule, its unique information transmitting abilities, how it codes for proteins, how those proteins move out and become the workhorses that run the cells, that do the important part of cellular and, it turns out, intercellular communication. But to tell the story of the brain and to answer the charges that we face tonight, we need to move beyond this. We need to tell a different part of the story. And ladies and gentlemen, this is the part that doesn't get told as often. Our story today is about why DNA by itself is not enough to explain life as we know it. It's the story about how organisms are able to adapt during their lifetimes. To express this, I need to give you an analogy that the non-biologists will understand. It's the story of the difference between the Encyclopedia Britannica and Facebook. The Encyclopedia Britannica contains an immense amount of information and costs an immense amount of money to publish, buy, and cart with you back and forth across the country, as I've done. Periodically, this monster was updated to match the growth of knowledge. It was the Bible of knowledge, right? It was the standard for knowledge, as those of you with gray hair like me will remember. And if you're under 20, you probably wonder, why is he putting a bunch of books on the board, right? This structure works, ladies and gentlemen, when you have a bunch of static information. Information you don't have to change very often, and you just want to make copies of it. My German friends are excellent at this. They publish things like RGG and Regierung, Geschichte und Gegenwart that are multi-volumes, and you know, they feel so proud, we've just done the fourth edition. It took us 23 years, and it's all outdated by the time it appears. But they're very proud to have done it. Facebook doesn't work like that at all. Facebook works far better for ever-changing information in a world where nothing is constant. Ladies and gentlemen, evolution made a bet on Facebook, and you are it. No organism in the history of evolution made the investment in brain. A brain is a system able to respond to and program itself as the environment unfolds. And I'll end with this point because it's so important. I'd like to explain how that happens because it's the crux of our answer to the charge that we face tonight. Neurons are the classic example of Facebook. Here's the individual neuron. This is a static structure, it looks like, right? The dendrite, the nucleus, the soma, and then the axon stretching out, and then these terminal buttons that we'll look at in more detail later. But that is not the story. Now let's look more closely at the neurons. This is one, and I'm going to talk over it. So this gives you, this actually won an award, this tribulation from the Science Society. This kind of moves you through this forest of neurons. You can see that there's space between one neuron and the next, despite all that branching stuff. And that's the synaptic space we'll come back and talk to at the end. See the bud there at the end? And it has to transmit from one to another. This right there, if that were a hair, it would be 6 miles wide. That's how tiny these things and how greatly this is simulated. And in the surface are a whole variety of proteins which go about doing the work of the individual neuron. So this is, by this point of magnification, if this was a hair, it would be 6 miles wide, a human hair. But you see these individual proteins moving across the surface and doing the work of transmitting. Always it gets down to these tiny proteins, right? So the structure we understand from genetics and cell biology. But how these neurons work together, gives us something radical different. Okay, for the next one, that's the only one I needed to talk over, so you can, Craig's gonna turn it back up again. The neuron, individual neurons, are not yet the full story. Now, this one I need to turn up. Here's the movement of cells.
The big objects you see that neurons appear and then slowly go out of appearance, those are nerve cells that are being cut through. And coming off of these cells are these large, light-colored objects, which are the dendrites. Every little object in here is a little wire. To keep track of these cells from one section to another, what you'd like to do is kind of color them in. So every one of these colors have no meaning other than to keep track of each object from section to section. What this allows us to do is to generate a wiring diagram based on this. We now know everything about these wires here, and from that, we can generate all the connections of every cell in that area.
A complete wiring diagram of that portion of the brain based on the image that you looked at before, colored in by computers to recognize the individual wires. Again, it looks like wires and chemicals. That's all we are, wires and chemicals, right? Let's keep going. What you noted in that picture, the clip, was the movement. And what I want to challenge the speaker here is it's not this that's the important story of the brain, though it's indispensable. It was the movement that you saw earlier on. What matters is that constant evolution of the brain and what's causing that evolution. If you get that, I think you get the answer to the conundrum. The position is called neural Darwinism. Gerald Edelman is the author of that view. As we study the development of brains, especially embryonic brains, we recognize that it sends out these connectors. They're called primary neuron groups. But these are, what they do is not just caused by the genes, by genetic programming, but also by what are called epigenetic events. That means events from above the level of the gene. The one word you want to remember is epigenetic. Things that happen above and beyond or outside of the level of the gene. These are changes in the brain that occur by activating or inhibiting genes without changing the sequence of the DNA itself. So what happens is these nerve cell connections move outward and they form these neuronal groupings which turn out are unique to each one of us. Two dogs don't form their neuronal groupings in exactly the same way. If it were just genetic determinism and that you have basically the same genes, let's say identical twins, you'd have the same connections. But even identical twins are forming the neuronal groupings differently, which tell us it's not at the level of the gene, it's something above the level of the gene. So these axons, these dendritic connections, are similar in animals of the same species, but they're subject to significant individual variation. It's this variation that makes you as human beings the most adaptable animal on the face of the planet. You can adapt to a new environment because the part of your body that gets the hugest investment of blood flow, nutrition, weight, I mean off the charts compared to any other animal, that is the adapting and adaptable part of yourself. The part that's evolving as you live your life. Neural connections are made. Now we get to psychology. And the more they're used, the stronger the connections get, and the more permanent they become in the architecture of your brain. The connections you don't use, sorry to say it, begin to atrophy like a muscle. It is true, use it or lose it. What you use frequently lays down neural connections that last for decades. A fact that you often access, your favorite phone numbers, names you frequently recall, books and memories and films that you talk about a lot, they remain accessible longer. Does anyone remember their phone number from when they were a child? Say it out loud. Amazing! See? And you haven't thought of it for how long? Right? When somebody gets very old, my grandmother had Alzheimer's, but she could tell stories about her youth flawlessly because she laid down such deep pathways, they just didn't go away. Even though she couldn't tell you what day, week, month, or year it was, she certainly knew about those early memories. And that's because these dendrites have evolved, right? The neurons have evolved and laid down these structures that don't go away. By the way, it means that those of you who strive to use your brain as you go through your life, like coming to this lecture, hearing new stuff, are going to have the most flexible, adaptable brains. And those of you who sit in front of your same soap opera reruns, right, are the ones who are going to have the static brains. Use it or lose it. The term that we use for that, I put up on the board a minute ago, is called neuroplasticity. That's the word for the flexibility and adaptability of your brain. Studies have shown that brains can rewire after a stroke. Studies recently have shown plasticity in people over the age of 80, so that when given new tasks and then they do the brain scans, they are laying down new neural pathways. You can teach an old dog new tricks. And there's actually an experiment, was an experiment at Harvard done by Terrence Deacon, not that I agree with it ethically, where they reprogrammed a frog's brain, the neurons, slashed out the visual center, and then, I know what they did. They placed a third eye on his forehead. I was going to show it, but it was so great, I thought I'd just have you imagine. They surgically implanted an eye with the neurons into the brain, and the frog's brain grew a whole set of neurons to use the third eye, even though it had never evolved for that purpose before. And it did it by using the auditory cortex. So the part of the brain normally for hearing got reprogrammed to let a frog see actually with three eyes. I mean, the degree of neuroplasticity is off the charts. Off the charts. And when I argue at the end of this talk that you are, for all intents and purposes, free, it has everything to do with this term neuroplasticity. Let's move on. Now we have to talk about consciousness. There's so much data, I'm going to limit myself just to four, but I wanted just four examples to try to blow your mind, pun intended, a little bit, right? Because it turns out that, please have a seat, you guys, we're very informal. Come on up, you know, you can sit in front. Popcorn will be here in a minute, right? So this is very relaxed. We're just probing whether you're free or not to come or go, right? If I say nobody's free to leave. All right. I'm going to limit myself to four examples because we've got to move on and solve this challenge that we're struggling with today. But let me just give you a sense of how close the connections are between neural changes and what you experience. We'll start with Huntington's disease. Now this starts with a genetic mutation on chromosome 4 and a particular sequence of just three nucleotides, right? This tiny little cystosine, adenine, and guanine, three of the four rungs of the DNA ladder. This sequence gets repeated between 36 and 120 times in the people with Huntington's instead of the normal 10 to 28 times. So you're just repeating a few chemicals, right, in the strand, by this through this disease. The result then produces a particular protein which we call Huntington, and it turns out to be toxic to the neurons in these regions that you can see on the slide. So the neurons begin to degenerate, and then patients show those symptoms that you know from Huntington's disease: jerky movements, dementia, personality change, irritability, they become disinhibited, forgetful, anxious. Finally, their speech deteriorates. They have high rates of depression and suicide. And we know the link between repeating a few segments, right? A few parts of the DNA, a few of those nucleotides, and these psychological manifestations. Oliver Sacks is famous for some of the most amazing research. This is a case documented by Oliver Sacks, in which a lesion on the left occipital and the temporal lobes it's the yellow lines, but in the particular brain, it was just on the left side, resulted in a patient being unable to recognize objects. Visual agnosia. Although the patient's memory and his capacity for abstract thoughts were great, and the guy could do philosophy, he could get an A on a philosophy paper in Sister Kathleen's class or something, he began to confuse his foot with his shoe. He was unable to recognize his family members in photographs. Again, this guy gets A's in philosophy, but this happens. And most famously, Oliver Sacks even named a book after it. He tried to pick up his wife's head, thinking it was a hat. Right? What was the title of the book? The man who confused his...
Mistook
his wife for a hat. Something that we assume she didn't appreciate, as much as she may have loved hats. Now here's this guy, if you ask him to talk about proofs of the existence of God, he'll go on and on. But then when he's finished, he picks up his wife's head and tries to put it on the coat rack, which she didn't appreciate.
Yeah.
Right? And this is from a very specific lesion in a very specific part of the brain. That's how close the connections are. Now, physical changes in the brain affect not only motor and language functions, also fundamental personality traits, such as creativity, and for us, especially important, spirituality. This is the case, you see him here, Tommy McHugh. He was a builder who had a near-fatal brain hemorrhage in 2001. Since that time, he's had this insatiable urge to make art, whether painting, poetry, writing, sculpting. He spends hours every day on this art. See the pictures? But he says he feels unable to stop himself from doing so. A brain hemorrhage, so blood damages brain tissue, and for years afterwards, he's driven to do this. I would love to present the data from Ramachandran at UC San Diego, but he studies damaged lesions to the lower temporal lobe, and he finds that his patients with damage, which he can locate exactly what region, develop increased spirituality, and they begin building altars in their homes. They spend many hours a day in prayer and meditation, and they report a constant sense of the presence of God, or timelessness, or the self dissolving into the all. So, I mean, their Buddhist meditation teacher, or their rabbi, or their pastor is completely thrilled. Yeah. Like, the guy's become so spiritual, look at this, right? Or the Hindu guy who's got his altar. The sad thing is, it's a lesion, it's a damage in a particular region that has caused this growth in spirituality. They aren't freely worshiping God. They are, like McHugh here, they are compelled to be spiritual. That's kind of a frightening thought. And finally, this one, the craziest of all. This is psilocybin chemical. And there have been recent studies on the drug psilocybin. Johns Hopkins University, that proved that religious or mystical experiences can be chemically induced. You see here, just this chemical progression from that one above, on the psilocybin, there on the far side, which has amazing effects in brains. Here's what that does. There's a placebo. People didn't know if they were really getting psilocybin or a placebo. But the differences in the brain firing, especially access of memory, but a whole bunch of other really significant brain firing, was different in the two cases. So Johns Hopkins found that the people coming out of this experience reported what all the studies showed, full mystical experience. A third of them rated this experience as the single most significant religious experience of their life. Two-thirds ranked it among the five most significant experiences of their life. For many of them, it led to positive changes in behavior that lasted for months or years after the experiment. And at 6 months, I think it was, on the Johns Hopkins study, they were reporting that this remained among the most significant experiences of their life. That, it's a chemical. It happens to be found in about 200 varieties of mushrooms. But that chemical placed into the brain causes the different firings, and people become permanently transformed in a positive spiritual direction, usually in accord with their particular upbringing. Buddhist, Hindu, Jewish, Muslim, Christian, they have, with their brains kind of primed for that kind of experience, they have an experience of the Blessed Virgin, or an experience of Ein Sof, if it's Kabbalistic Judaism, or an experience of Jesus if they are raised in a Christian environment. Chemical, brain firing, spiritual experience, transformation of life. I find that troubling. All right, let's move in our last minutes then, last 20 minutes, toward a solution. I suggest that the solution lies in this approach, an approach that we call embedded, embodied cognition. I think this is the route that begins to head us toward the solution that we need. This embedded, embodied cognition is the view that our consciousness emerges from the interplay between brain, body, and world. These major terms of our talk, brain, cognition, consciousness, and the world, none of these four can be understood in isolation from the others. They represent a single interconnecting system. Parts of this system are inside the body, and parts are in the surrounding environment. Parts are physical, like neurons, and parts of the system are non-physical, like your ideas, thoughts, passions, wishes, dreams, your representations of the environment that are part of your mental world, your representations of your mother, your best friend, your children, inside your head. These are part of that same interlocking system. I suggest that only when all are taken together do we have an adequate explanation of brains and consciousness. This is a major research program in recent years. I'm not going to take the time to describe the different authors' views, but all of these are part of the school of embedded, embodied cognition. Those of us who espouse EEC, we call it, prefer to speak of the mind-brain, right? We prefer to speak of that close connection of the environment and the individual. We think of an interactive space between the people around you, the salient features of your environment, yourself, your brain, your body, your personhood. Do you understand? Linked together as part of a single interlocking system. We don't privilege the mental, but we don't reduce everything to the physical. No dualism here. We are not Cartesian. The one thing we're sure of is Descartes was wrong. But rather we speak of an integrated system. So there's always a neurophysiological basis. That's what we've been looking at. And then there's the cognitive program that the brain runs. That's what it evolved to do. And it created these cognitive programs as it sought to adapt to its environment. But remember, ladies and gentlemen, that the environment is not only physical beings in our environment. For social animals, the environment is social. For human beings, the environment is persons. Let me say that differently. Your brain, those neurons, are adapting and growing in the way they do in response to the persons around you. If the infant has a mother who smiles on her in those early days and weeks of life, her brain is evolving. Her nervous system, her hormonal system are evolving differently. Do you remember the the chimpanzees who had the surrogate mother in the 1950s? They wouldn't let you do this nowadays, right? And half of them had this, it was a wire frame, and in some cases it was covered, it was vaguely chimpanzee-like, covered in a soft, easy fur that the chimp could come and hug, and the other was the bare frame. And the chimp who could not hug something soft and warm developed to lack social abilities, was unable to mate later in life and so forth. And the chimp who had the surrogate mother like a mother, remember the babies that were failing to thrive in the orphanages, and somebody said, pick them up not less than once an hour and hold them for whatever minutes. And the death rate dropped incredibly quickly. do you understand? Your brain and self and physical body is evolving differently based on the interaction with human beings. Not only that, ideas. In an idea-rich environment, a different brain evolves. We knew that when I was a kid because they had the little, what were they called? The things above the cradle?
Mobiles,
right? And they thought that would add to the development of the brain. They were right. Now we find that children in text-rich environments around the world develop more complex brains, literally, perceptibly, and those with text-poor environments, like no books at home. That's why reading to your kids is so important. Develop different brains. Embedded, embodied cognition. Thought, self, brain, world, environment. All part of a piece evolving together. I suggest that's the core of our answer to the challenge. We get this in part by looking at the evolutionary history of other animals. I'm going to have to move quickly here. Here's the difference between the human brain along the top level and the bonobo brain along the lower level. See? Smooth, little folding, very little striation. Look at the human brain. All the folding that turn out there are multiple levels, and then the striation that is a part of the human brain. That's an anatomical complexity. Now, bonobo brains produce incredible ways of relating to the environment. Who knows the work of Sue Savage-Rumbaugh? Actually, Maynard would know. And Kanzi. Here's a clip of Kanzi. Make this, Greg, make this really loud, because she's giving verbal clues only. And watch how Kanzi can understand. Oh, there's another. You see the difference between the brains, human brains, and then these monkey brains.
Kanzi and I are on our way to make a fire. We're interested in the origins of human culture and the origins of human mind. Not only do humans diverge because of language, but humans clearly diverge because of their ability to make a fire. And he really enjoys it. He's figured out how to use lighters and matches.
A lighter properly.
Put it on the fire. Yeah, put it down. I'll get the food in it.
She's just like a mom.
Kanzi understands about traveling to different places, and he understands about what we're cooking in the fire.
That's a perfect marshmallow stick. That's one of the best I've seen. It's not done. There, you got it burning. Can you put the fire out before we go? Oops, you didn't take the top off.
See, she didn't gesture.
You forgot to take the top off.
Just verbal alone.
Save some for the fire.
What do you think, Kanzi? The most complex language use of any non-human ever. I can tell you it's a whole talk just on Kanzi. But and she now lived, I think she ran out of funding because she got blacklisted by the reductionist scientists who thought this wasn't science. But Sue Savage-Rumbaugh and her colleagues lived with a group of bonobos in
Iowa.
It was Iowa, yeah. And the bonobos taught their children the language that they used, taught their children how to potty train. They lived in a house together and began to develop a second generation, actually third generation, because Kanzi's parents were trained as well with lexigrams. A third generation of language using bonobos living in a complexity of communication not possible in the wild, right? An incredible movement forward, and yet you hit a limit. It's an interaction of bonobo brain, body, surrounding an environment which is language rich, which is nurturing and loving, as you could see from Sue's response, and yet there's still a limit. And I want to name that limit now as I move to the closing part of my talk. A quote from an incredible book, I'll come back to that. See, the limit is, why did they make me? Why am I here? Why do I die? What happens to me when I do? These aren't questions that the bonobo is asking. He does love marshmallows. They do train their children to potty train, They do transmit the use of lexigrams and verbal cues from parent to child. They do even vocalize back to Sue in ways that she can understand. I think most of us have a harder time understanding, right? But what's the difference? Ooh, where did I, maybe I move it to the end? Oh, I'll just put it here. What I think we're seeing is emergent mind. It's correlated to the brain and brain complexity, but it's also more than the brain and brain complexity. Do you understand? The title of tonight's talk is to understand how out of this brain world connection, mind, mental thoughts, sense of self emerges. But it's also constrained by the complexity of the brain that can do that. So when you have the chimp and the human, until the age of 18 months, an adult chimp or bonobo clearly outperforms the human child in every cognitive measure. The fully formed chimp or bonobo brain has higher capacity than the mostly unwired human brain. But between 18 and 36 months, the human child, unless there's a deficit in the brain, the human child passes every other animal. Melvin Connor has picked it up better than anyone else I know. He writes, in The Tangled Wing, Biological Constraints of the Human Spirit, in an engaging study of the conversations of three-year-olds, in the context of a longer chat between a little boy and girl, this phrase occurred. Hello, Mr. Dinosaur. Hello, Mr. Skeleton. Listen, these three-word sentences probably contain enough complexity, enough levels of meaning, and enough imagination to ensure that comparable things will never be said by even the most brilliant talking ape. He says, I suspect that we are seeing in this example the most rudimentary form of the key to being human. And now he's speculating. This is not science. But this is where we need to go and get to go at this point in the talk. He calls it this, a sort of wonderment at the spectacle of the world and its apprehensibility by the mind, a focusing for the sheer purpose of elevation, an intelligent waking dream. In that capacity, perhaps, we find our greatest distinction, and it may be our salvation. Something happens by 36 months or so that makes us capable of a genuine spiritual life and practice and belief that transforms our mode of being in the world in a way that no animal on this planet is able to do in the same way. Now, Melvin Connor is a secular Jew. There's no belief in God to get in his way. In the close of our talk, I want to name the question in the title explicitly, what about faith, religious belief, and spiritual practices? You know, so much is said in the popular literature about what brains are. Is the brain a computer? Is it a creator? Is it a container? Is it antenna? And what actually is this brain? Well, probably, ladies and gentlemen, none of the above. But it is that part of ourselves, that part of our body, that forms our sense of self more than any other part of who we are. I'm often asked whether neuroscience proves or disproves God. And I suppose it won't surprise you to hear that the answer is none of the above. Let's take on the charge first, the charge that neuroscience disproves God. This is the one part of the talk that's technical. I'm just going to leave it, and if you get blurred over, don't worry, I'm done in 3 minutes, okay? It has to do with the claim that brains are deterministic systems, and therefore they rule out any role for knowing or experiencing God. And listen to the answer. We've already seen that genes don't determine the brain, right? The brain is this evolving system, epigenetic, not programmed by genes. It also turns out that neurons don't determine cognitive processes in the way that, say, the electronics of your computer, you know, determine it when it does a math sum that comes out with the same answer every time. when we do math sums, we miss up about half the time, right? Something's different in the way our brains function, which is our genius at the same time. Look at the neural synapse. Can you turn off the volume just on this one? Okay, so there's an action potential that travels down along the neuron to the synapse. See the synaptic junction? And what it does is it creates a readiness potential right there at the end, and the readiness potential causes these little vesicles to move to the surface and to send out little molecules, little chemicals, into the synapse, the neural synapse, and these are called neurotransmitters. They move across the space, and then there are these protein receptors on the other end, and they bond, see, like this, this one bonds to receptor, this one bonds to receptor, these fall just in the space in between and don't have that impact. Enough bond to these receptors, and then that creates a readiness potential that's transferred in the new neuron, it's called the postsynaptic neuron, onward into the body of the cell, okay? And then it happens, and that transfer becomes electric. We can register it with as an electric charge. But this, friends, this is chemical in between. Now, listen, the adult human brain is estimated to contain 100 to 500 trillion synapses. Each of you has not less than 100 trillion of these things in your brain. Every cubic millimeter, that's tiny, every cubic millimeter of your cerebral cortex contains roughly a billion synapses. That's packed in there, right? Makes New York look small by comparison. This cleft here, the synaptic cleft, isn't static, however. This is not a deterministic system. In fact, there may be quantum effects. A lot of us think that that's probably true. It can be more or less efficient, more or less receptive to these neurotransmitters at different times. It's called potentiation and depression. So the ability to transmit that stuff through there increases and decreases constantly. What causes that? The state of the synapses are caused by systemic factors in your body, rest, nutrition, and level of activity. They're affected by hormones in your body, like adrenaline and estrogen, as men and women all well know, and psychological factors, such as you're being hopeful or depressed, affect the chemistry of each one of 500 trillion synapses. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not a deterministic system. And this is the philosophical argument. This one actually stands up in a philosophical debate. There is therefore no bottom-up account of synaptic transmission. Hence, there's no bottom-up account of brain functioning as a whole. Hence, there's no bottom-up account of mind. Hence, neuroscience can never disprove God. On the other hand, is the God spot. No. The first book came out in 1997, and this is 2012. People are still excited to say, where's the God spot? Where does God transmit God's messages into our brains? Okay. Point to it, right? People love this. There's a whole discipline called neurotheology that involves looking for the God spot and speculating how our brains prove God. Okay, we know what brain areas are activated in different kinds of spiritual experience. Attention focus, the sense of cosmic unity, inner spiritual non-ego, response to spiritual images, religious and spiritual emotion. We can tell you where that stuff happens, but ladies and gentlemen, none of that creates a God spot, right? It just means that certain kinds of activities are affected. Therefore, brains neither prove God nor disprove God. Neuroscience doesn't put you in either direction. Irreducible place remains for faith. Now let me close. What does remain is practice. Spiritual practice is where recent neuroscience takes us. I just don't have time to do all the details. Here's people with, you see effects after just 6 weeks of practice of transcendental meditation. And you can see this regular eyes closed rest. And people who've learned this transcendental meditation technique, this is Andrew Newberg and his colleagues, 2006. marked differences increase frontal and parietal activity, decrease thalamic activity after just 6 weeks of practice, of a regular practice, of what some people would call spiritual but not even religious practice. And then this is amazing data. Whether it's Buddhists practicing pure consciousness or Franciscan nuns engaging in prayer to experience closeness with God, you have marked empirical differences, and both kinds of brains change in the same way, whether Buddhist or Catholic. Indeed, the changes begin to happen within 8 weeks of one or the other of those two practices. And if you do the practice for a few years, your thalamus permanently changes its structure by 10%. Permanently. You quit, and it doesn't go away. Ladies and gentlemen, we can literally change our brains through spiritual practice. Now, does that surprise the religious people in the room? That's been the heart of Jewish observance since the beginning. From the rabbinical period, Jews never said, you've got to get the few propositions about God right, and then you're okay. They said, it's about the observance. Torah calls us to observe the mitzvot. And working out the beliefs, that's something that can happen later, if it happens at all. The rabbis never worked out the beliefs, right? That's what it is to be a rabbi, I take it. Right? The Ignatian practices, spiritual practices, practice the Ignatian practices. That will transform you, whatever your beliefs might happen to be. For those of us in the Wesleyan tradition, the practice of sanctification is the growth through the Holy Spirit towards Christ-likeness, right? That is not about getting the propositions right, but allowing the Holy Spirit, by grace, to transform the inner self. In these different religious traditions, even more so in Buddhism and Hinduism, you can see the central place for spiritual practices. I just had to close, show you this in closing. This is a male subject, live responses of the brain as he engaged in meditation. In chanting, in Hindu chanting. And you can see the areas that are activating are personal meaning areas. The tension comes on and off. The auditory, of course. The visual, very minor. But then these meaning areas go darker and then brighter, so more blood flow as the meditation goes on. Literally, this brain is reprogramming itself as you watch. In conclusion, we share so many features with our animal cousins. Self-awareness and empathy shared with orangutans. The close relations that can grow between humans and gorillas. One of my favorite people in the world, I had the privilege of working with, Jane Goodall, developed, I would say, a spiritual kinship with the chimps that she worked with in Gombe. The animals, though the brains are more simple, develop in an embedded, embodied way a sense of self in relation to their environment in ways analogous to us. And yet, this species, in evolution, invested in this adaptable brain more than any other animal. In 1420, a Renaissance Catholic thinker named Pico della Mirandola got it right. Appealing back to the Genesis narrative, he said, in the form of a prayer, in the form of God speaking to Adam, thou art confined by no bounds, thou wilt fix limits of nature for thyself, flexible brain. I have placed thee, Adam, at the center of the world. Thou art the molder and maker of thyself. Thou mayst sculpt thyself into whatever shape thou dost prefer, spiritual practices. Thou canst grow downward into the lower natures, which are brutes. Thou canst again grow upward from thy soul's reason into the higher natures, which are divine. Faith in neuroscience, no problem. Thanks very much.
Such an amazing talk, no? Really wonderful. Thank you so much, Phil. And Phil now will entertain a few questions. So if you have one, please raise your hand, and Andrea or I will hand you the microphone.
And I'm going to make Greg's life hard by wandering as I go. Is that okay, Greg?
It's okay.
All right.
I would appreciate
appreciate your response to what sounds like a way out question, but.
Speak up really loud, even though the mic, yeah. And yeah, Greg can make
talk
me.
Into it.
Yeah.
Okay, I would appreciate your response to what may appear to be a way out question, but you had mentioned your theory, the model of embodied cognition. Mm-hmm. Well, there are some really strong AI theorists, Guy Carnegie Mellon, Ray Kurzweil, who talk about like in 10,000 years, 100,000 years, theoretically we could recreate our brains perfectly precisely, mm-hmm. and upload it into a computer,
yep.
and achieve immortality. However, no nutrition, no blood, no, maybe yep. social interaction with others who are being uploaded, but what is your response to that
yep.
futuristic scenario?
Yeah, thank you for that question. That's extremely important. I completely disagree. I think that that's bad science. AI, artificial intelligence, came to dominate the entire discussion. To the point, oh, we got it in our science fiction, we got it in Star Trek, end of 3, wasn't it, when Spock uploaded his brain into a computer? Oh no, into somebody else's brain, didn't he? And then it was the beginning of 4 that McCoy got it downloaded back into his resurrected body on whatever that planet was. I should get somebody in the room's gonna know what planet that was, right? You guys, that requires, that would be putting it into somebody else's brain, which doesn't work for the reasons that these neural connections develop over years. Ray Kurzweil wants to put it into a digital computer. The problem is that synaptic story I told you at the very end. If those synapses are not deterministic systems, like your computer working the math equation 998 plus 473, what's the answer? He's got it. No, your brain, your computer already knows the answer, right? Because it's hardwired to do that. For you, your level of alcohol, caffeine, tiredness, exercise, estrogen, testosterone is going to affect what happens in every one of those trillions of connections. That is not a digital system. It is an analog system. Therefore, to try to hold it within a digital system is not to retain all of what it has. So the two things to remember, the analogical complexity, and if there are quantum effects, the essential indeterminism of your brain, and second, the fact that it is formed and maintained by constant interaction with an environment, which is, you know, dogs, trees, doorways, whatever, sunlight, but it's also persons, ideas, love, self-esteem, everything that the spiritual traditions have talked about is a part of that day-by-day interaction, which is making and remaking your brain constantly in real time. I'm really glad you raised the question because it's a flawed model. What we call brute force AI didn't work, in our opinion, and the model of embodied embedded cognition began to be developed, actually already in 1982, with a work of Francisco Varela and Maturano, but grew to prominence over the 1990s and into the first decade of the present century. There's so much bad, false information. You know, they can bet their quarter that someday they'll solve the question of the human brain with brute force AI. That doesn't make it so. I'm betting my quarter, I'll put more than a quarter on the table, that's bad science. Others? Howard, and there's a question here also. Whoever, the people with the mics have the power, so whatever, Sister Kathleen.
I think it's the science time. I guess my bigger question would be.
Wait, real close and talk up.
My bigger question would be: is you expressed how apes are evolving, but they hit a wall. If that's the case, how do we know that they hit a wall? It might not be enough time to know if they actually hit a wall.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it's more of a statement.
No, that's a great question. And actually, I stand corrected. From what's your first name?
Tommy.
By Tommy's question. So bonobos in our lifetime, the lifetime of everyone in this room, have done things with language that have never happened in the history of that species before by changing the conditions, right? They are using more complex language. Kanzi had let me get started telling stories, but he had a massive vocabulary. He learned it passively as they tried to train his adopted parents. And then he came up and started signing with this lexigram It's another story we don't have time to talk about. And then it was replicated in a community of bonobos at the maximum was 16, I think, living in this house like kids in a family and being spoken to verbally, responding verbally. Lots of data. You can just look up Sue Savage Rumbaugh, R-U-M-B-A-U-G-H, I think. Savage like S-A-V-A-G-E, Savage Rumbaugh, and you can see lots of clips and debate about it, right? So we don't know how far bonobos will go. They have broken every prediction of what an animal could do. In the 1950s, it was claimed that humans were the only animals that used tools. False, blatantly false, right? In the 1950s, it was claimed that only humans had culture, animals don't have culture. Now we have culture so much through the great apes that if you ask the expert at Xerxes Center outside Atlanta, he says, show me any clip of great apes in the world without any environmental cue, and I'll tell you where they are by how they interact. He says, their culture is so clear to me, I can empirically verify exactly which one it is by seeing them. Now we found culture down to the level of birds. So well down the evolutionary tree, we find cultural differences that are transmitted. Okay, so we don't know the limits of bonobos. Now, that raises the question, what about human beings? Right? Are we inherently violent, egotistical? Will we inherently see something that needs to change and refuse to change because our brains can't do it? Because we, Tommy, have the same limits that the bonobos have, or that I claim that they have. If that's true, we are in bad shape. If humans see that we are corrupting our planet and bringing about the death of hundreds of millions of people, the loss of the biodiversity that our own life requires, the loss of the water resources to keep us alive, and if we do nothing, is that a part of our brains being so programmed to selfishness and short-term gain that we simply can't do it? And that is the biggest question on the face of this planet. And I hope that Tommy's right. The bonobos will break the predictions of what they could do, and I pray to God that human beings will break the apparent predictions of what we're going to do, wake up, and begin acting like people with wisdom and not short-term cavemen. Thank you.
Howard has a mic.
I'm going to ask you a question. That's
keep basic. It real close, though, because they can.
Okay, I'll try to do this. I'm going to ask you a question which is based upon a fairly rudimentary kind of philosophical analysis that emerges from an old piece of logical positivist philosophy. At the beginning of your talk, you point to a situation that raises the possibility of a looming moral and spiritual catastrophe. Arising from the possibility that human thought, consciousness, spiritual awareness may all possess causal explanations in terms of underlying biochemical and neuronal mechanisms which can be seen as deterministic. And from this, you cite
okay, so yeah, get to the challenge. I want to be criticized.
Okay. Moritz Schlick, in his old book, Fragen der Ethik, pointed out that conundrums of this sort can be seen as pseudo-problems, mm-hmm. not real problems, because they rest upon the tacit but incorrect assumption that causal determination is the opposite of free will, when in fact causal determination is not the opposite. The opposite of causal determination is randomness, not lack of human freedom. And therefore, our worries about a looming catastrophe, however valid these reflections upon emerging sciences of cognition may be, the anxiety that we may have that the underpinnings of human moral sensibilities and spirituality, it may simply rest upon the bewitchment of the mind by failing to note a logical fallacy.
Okay, so I may have a go. That's actually, this is a really hard topic, and I actually don't think that Marsh Schlitz gets us off the hook so easily. I just spent a couple of years working on this question in this book, In Quest of Freedom, The Emergence of Spirit in the Natural World. I think I showed tonight that humans aren't determined by our brains or environment or genes. Right. So I now argue with the philosophers afterwards. We'll be here at midnight, as Howard said, burning midnight oil. We'll still be fighting over it. But I think I can show that determinism fails. Right? Have I therefore shown that we're free?
Right.
I think I haven't.
Right.
Can neuroscience show that we're free in a positive sense? No, in my opinion. Can evolutionary biology show that we're free in a positive sense? I would argue no. Biology can show that you get more and more complex brains, central nervous systems, organisms, with more and more, listen, spontaneity of behavior. So at Villanova yesterday, Father Allen, remember, we talked about dogs and wolves in play behavior, where there's spontaneity differences in every individual animal, just like there's differences in the brain wiring, right? Does that make the dog free in that play? No. It just means there's more variability. Now you get human children on the playground, variability. Does that prove freedom? No. What happens, do you guys know what an asymptotic curve is? It goes up and up like this, but it never quite meets the y-axis, right? Humans gain more and more spontaneity without ever hitting the axis, proving that we're really free, metaphysically free. A human being can invent Hogwarts, right? A human being can write a Mozart symphony, can say, let me not to the marriage of true spirits admit impediments, for love is not love when it alteration finds, or bends with a remover to remove, right? To be or not to be. Humans can come with incredible designs. E equals mc squared, theory of the universe, theory of everything. Does that prove we're free? Or just that we have so much spontaneity, we can do virtually everything? And I argue here that only from the standpoint of a religious or spiritual tradition can one make the claim that we actually have freedom. It's an argument developed by Karl Rahner, a Catholic theologian, that I think is an incredibly powerful argument. And that's something I recommend for the brainy, you're all brainy, but for the brainy among you, is to look at that question, what really would be needed to constitute human freedom? There's a vibrant hand from a philosopher.
So based on the research that we've seen, Dr. Clayton, are we to expect that the bonobo brain animal will be in our praise and worship classes? or church services and be able to respond?
Yeah. So that's a great question. It lets me say three things that are maybe funny, but maybe important, right? So Tommy asked us to think about the evolution.
Exactly.
How far will we see a more complex brain evolve in 1,000 generations of bonobos brought up in households and treated like human children? Right? What's the limit? Second, Jane Goodall described once being behind a group of single males, so non-attached males, chimpanzees in Gombe National Preserve. And they headed up a little side line of the big river that they'd never been up before. They came around the corner, and she's following behind, just watching. And they suddenly encountered a huge waterfall. It dropped like 100 feet, pouring down. It was spring, so it's a lot of water. Spray crashing up. And she said they froze, just fascinated, completely fixated on it. And then she said they raised their hands over their heads and began dancing around in circles. And now a little beyond what I myself would believe, a Lutheran chaplain named Anna First at the robotics lab at MIT, studying these developing robots named Cog and Kismet, said that at some point they will have learned so much in their freely evolving behaviors that it becomes an ethical and religious question whether it's right to unplug them, and asked, maybe someday I might have an obligation to baptize them. Unless they're Jewish, which in which case that wouldn't be a really good thing to do, right?
Well, I can tell you what you can do instead.
Yeah, right, the mikvah, right? But just not with water, please. So who knows, right? Where are the lines? Who knows? We've got to give this man a microphone. I see urgency.
So you're talking about free will.
Do it really close so they can hear you.
So you're talking about free will, and toward the end of your talk, you were talking about how you can expand or contract the size and capability of certain parts of the brain relative to certain practices. And the same thing with a three-year-old brain with regard to reading to them at night. Are you suggesting, are you making the implication that free will is not an instantaneous thing, but a trained and practiced thing over a long period of time?
Yes, brilliant. That's the philosopher's mind. A necessary condition for the development of free will is A, the evolution of the complex brain. So rich environment, right? B, the training and practices over time, but that's still not sufficient. The third, I believe, is a level of reality outside the level of the biological, which gets at the level of that ground of being. This is Karl Rahner's argument, that calls to the ground of who we are. And I argue anyway that one can't make sense of that robust understanding of free will, it's called libertarianism or metaphysical free will, without that third dimension as well. Three necessary conditions.
It's our turn.
Say it really loud.
If it's not too personal, would you say what your practice is or how you do it?
That's a fair question. So I grew up in the Christian tradition, and I currently teach as a Wesleyan at a Wesleyan seminary. Most of my academic training was from Catholics, and including a famous ex-Jesuit student of Catholic mysticism named Louis Dupre at Yale, whom I owe so much to for the practices that he brought, the traditional practices. But over the last 20 years now, I've been on an inter-religious journey. So I locate as a Christian, but I don't feel that stops me from practicing the traditions of other traditions. And I have been transformed by conversations with Jewish and Muslim friends who bring practices that I haven't known and that have enhanced my life and understanding. Doing the walk of the Zen temples outside of Tokyo on the way to the ocean and meditating under the direction of Zen Buddhist monks. And then I've been a guest professor in India and learned meditation from Hindu friends. You probably don't know that the Hindu tradition has a tradition called bhakti, which is devotion, that's very similar to Abrahamic practices of devotion to God. And they bring a richness of practice that I don't think I ever would have achieved without that. For me, it's not a matter of just sort of grabbing onto anything like, you know, kid in a candy store, but rather having a location, a deep, personal, spiritual location, and then enhancing that through friendships with other traditions who do parts of it better than we ourselves do.
I would just like to say, the brain may be very complex, and it may have a lot of flexibility, but it boils down to whether or not you believe, at least I think it does, boil down to whether or not you believe there are supernatural forces. If you believe that everything has to follow physics and chemistry, then there is a wall for the brain. There is a limitation. But I think the argument about free will or predetermination, I thought a lot about this, and I came to the conclusion that you'll never know for certain, and you have to live life as free will, because if it's not predetermined, you live it as determined, you're in deep trouble.
Yeah. Nice. So in other words, there's almost a decision, right? Which is a practice. I shall live as if I am free. Weinger called it the philosophie des as ob, the philosophy of the as if. I shall live as if I am free. That maximizes the chance that I will live in a richer, more value-based way. And whether I really am free, that's for the good Lord to decide, right, in the end. I do want to just challenge one assumption. It wasn't your main point, and your body language made me feel connected, that we were connected in position as I gave the talk. So I think we share mostly in common, but the argument that physics or chemistry determines is what I challenge. So as an emergent mind means there are constant levels of emergent determination. Emergent influence is a better word. Physics is a level. Evolutionary biology is another level, so biochemistry. Darwinian forces, psychology, social learning, sociology, cultural imprint, spiritual practice. Each of those is a level of emergent influence upon us. Now the question at the end of the day is there another level beyond all natural levels as a whole? That's where you started in the beginning. A supernatural level of influence, right? And I just want to make really clear, when you raise that question, you leave the realm of the natural sciences and what they can tell us behind. And you enter in the realm of what I call comparative metaphysics, what the great traditions of the world have said, and what are the reasons pro and con. And because that's such a sharp line, I call it theological dualism. Everything we can say about emergent mind up to the question, but is there really a God? And at that point, the scientist stops talking as scientist, and we all talk as mystics, as questers, as I say, spiritual practitioners. And I don't think we disagree on that, but I just want to make sure the line is not physics and chemistry and everything else. The line is the entire natural order, and that question, is there a ground of all things natural, of all things created, that transcends that order? Okay, we're going to be up till 12, I can tell.
This is the power of unity and diversity, right?
She gets
them.
I feel that the program is just so evident about the unity and diversity.
That's beautiful.
The power of unity and diversity, I think, was experienced by all the what was shared with the people as well. Yeah. I thank you for tonight.
Thank you. Because we're vastly different in our programming, our background, our age, our gender, right? And our religious. We represent five or six different religious communities and some who wouldn't call themselves religious at all. And yet we have common ground as human beings. I get to speak to large Chinese groups of Chinese students in China frequently. They're so much like us, like our college kids, Japanese kids, Swedish kids, South African kids, right? There's so much in common that we share despite what incredible diversity separates us across the cultures. And I love your phrase, unity and diversity, because it celebrates that fact. Do we have time? I'm thinking a closing question.
Yeah, Michelle has a question.
Michelle gets the last word. Is Sister Kathleen, are you going to say that's the last one? Or no?
Yes, that is the last
one. All right, oh boy, I get the last word. So I had three things to say, but I'm going to pick only one of them, which is to say that Paul Tillich talks about faith as being transcending reason, and it's the self ecstatically reaching forward. So in some ways, it feels like this emergence is another way of reaching beyond the limits of the chemistry and the physics. And so, you know, I think about there is a leap, there is a risk involved in doing that. That's the as if, right? I will live as if is to take that risk. So that might be my last word on it all. I'll ask you about quorum sensing later.
Yeah. That's a great closing question. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight's talk was advertised as a question about neuroscience, the brain, which means it's a biology question, right? Neuroscience. It turns out that what we discovered is the yes to biology, all that we can learn from it, and something more. Tillich's major influence was a philosopher named Martin Heidegger. And Heidegger said that the nature of Dasein, to be us, existential beings in the world, was to be sich vorweg, always ahead of oneself. Sich vorweg, always ahead of oneself, even though we're always in the world and together with beings. He called that care, or caring, which is a beautiful phrase. As a human being, as a conscious person, you are already the system that you're a part of, and your own conscious experience of it, your own conscious evaluation of it. Whenever another human being becomes conscious, Whitehead says, the system is increased by one. right? Transcended. And in a beautiful book by Hofstadter called Gödel, Escher, Bach, he describes how every system with a conscious agent has already transcended the system. Because if you have 100 units, the conscious one has the 101st perspective on the other ones. So what I want to say at the end, and it really goes back to that question, I gamble on the side of being free, I shall live as if I am free, is to honor what we do most uniquely as conscious beings, which is to bring that unique point of light, that unique evaluation, namely the valuing of ourselves and those around us. The prophets call that compassion, to live with compassion for those around you and for yourself. And that, I would argue, is our single greatest moment of transcendence. And if we are free, that is our greatest freedom. Thank you so much.
So I just want to say, when I first used to go to these workshops, you know, about science and religion, you would have a scientist tell you about the science and then a theologian tell you about the theology, and you were left to put it together yourself. But today we have somebody who really integrates all of that, and I think it's a real thrill for me to see an embodied example of what we're trying to do here. So thank you again, Phil. It was really amazing. And do come back, be safe home, but do come back for our next year's wonderful slate of activities. Thank you.